Thank you. God bless you. Amen. We're just glad to be back home. Last week we were away, and the Lord really blessed us. And but it was a pleasure. We were going about 7 or 8 days. I got lonesome for Sister Hill about in the middle of that week. So I was just delighted to make it back yesterday. She met me at the airport. And had a real scrumptious, delicious dinner waiting for me. This is our season. We're celebrating our 50th wedding anniversary. Amen. So we just really feel blessed. Really feel blessed. Amen. And it was my pleasure to marry a young couple this morning before we started this service. And set up Jeremy and set up Dee Dee. Yes. All right. So, they received the Lord recently. And the Lord's hand is really on their lives. And we're just so happy that he called me. I was in Charlotte, North Carolina. He said, can you marry us today? I was in Charlotte. All right, but they were ready to get married. Amen. So they tied the knot this morning, and it was a pleasure. Those of you that were here early for service today, you had a special treat that you weren't expecting. Amen. So we just praise God for them. Amen. So happy for all of our special guests, and we invite all of our special guests to remain after church. It will be a special meal, is that right? Okay, in the honor of our 50th wedding anniversary, and I understand they have some real good. Don't want me to tell it? All right, you do want to stay for the food. Amen. Today it gives me great pleasure to present Brother Dean. Most of us have gotten acquainted with him and fell in love with his ministry, his music, his prophetic ministry, and he has been a real blessing. He's helping us in this interim period where we are building our music department. Amen. He has really been a tremendous blessing, and he goes beyond the call of duty. He's not the type that's just out for the money, because many times we're not able to give him what he deserves. Amen. He's just so humble, and he just say, I'm not here for the money. Amen. So that shows me his heart is in the right place. But more than that, up and above that, God's hand is upon his life. Amen. He is highly used of God. And we feel sometimes ago, a good while ago, that he will be a blessing. And he has also shared some things that he wanted to share with his body. Because I believe that God has bigger and better things for this ministry. Amen. I don't believe a half has been told that some great things are going to begin to happen. Amen. God confirmed that several Sundays ago. So without further delay, we're going to bring to you this great man of God, Brother Dean Heath. Amen. He's a pastor, evangelist, musician. He can do it all. So let's receive him. I say praise the Lord as he comes with the word of God.
Thank you, Pastor. Appreciate it. Are you glad to be here this morning? Yes. The psalmist said, I rejoiced when they said to me, let's go to the house of the Lord. And right now, in China, there are people meeting, groups of 30 and 40. And if they were to be discovered, they would be arrested. And so, I think sometimes in our country, the freedoms that we have, we sometimes forget the reality of this gospel and those that have gone before us and those that currently in what we call the 1040 window, which is that section of the earth that we understand has not been evangelized yet, those nations. And never before have we had these 24/7 news cycles where you can sit and watch CNN all night and all day and see news just immediately come to you. And I told Pastor that number one, I'm honored to be here. if you know me, you know I don't go places just to go or anything like that. I really feel like God has me here for a purpose, and I'm humbled by it. I have 6 children, and now I'm expecting the 7th. I just found out this week. And, so we actually are members of another a church near to our home, but my wife and I normally are together when we're... But this has been a very unique situation, and I believe it's God. And so we're living in days right now where, and Rod knows this, Coach deals with young people all the time, where you have a generation of young people that they're not going to just walk in here. They're not just going to walk in here on a Sunday morning. And we're going to have to hear what the scripture says. You know, Jesus never told his disciples, tell them to come. No, he told them, go. That's the operative word all through the New Testament, go. Leave the 99, go. And it's the heart of God. There were days for a season I've shared with some of you that I served at the Tulsa Dream Center at 46 in Cincinnati. And there were days I told my wife I'd make that drive home and with tears in my eyes, weeping, sometimes sobbing, seeing what's happening to our young people. How does that fit this morning in terms of us here, the church at Northside Christian Center? We are the church. We have a mandate from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I believe every person sitting here this morning, your life, your ministry, Paul said, all of us have been made able ministers, will and can have an impact on what happens outside of these four walls. And if you think about it, the impact has to do not with physical things, but has to do really with eternal things, things that will matter after this life. You know, you look at what's going on now with some of our sports, leadership, abuse, molestation. And I believe I'm here, part of my assignment is to ignite people and to activate people and take people from a place of dormancy and to see God ignite what is already on the inside of you this morning. And I say that humbly because I've been through some tough stuff the last few years, but if you'll just hang with me for a few minutes this morning, I believe you'll have something beneficial for your life, and I believe it'll be prophetic for this church in this location here on 46th Street North in Tulsa, Oklahoma. So there's some handouts that are going to pass out just so you can kind of follow along a little bit with some of the scriptures. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this morning. Thank you that you are a now God, that now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. Faith has always been how you function and you make things happen. And so, God, take us out of religious habits and just go through the motions this morning. And Holy Spirit, come and send your fire and send the love and shed it abroad in our heart by the Holy Ghost. People are dying and going to hell without you. And God, this morning, burn in us what the apostles and the disciples felt. They said, didn't our hearts burn when we were with him? And Jesus, walk up and down these aisles. And Lord, you're not just a 2,000 year ago God. You're a 2011 God. You initiated Facebook. You know more about computers than anybody. You're right now and you know what's going on and you know what the church is to do. And so make us like the sons of Issachar this morning that knew what to do because of their relationship with you. Your sheep hear your voice this morning, and the voice of the stranger they'll not follow. And I thank you for that voice I pray that I would decrease and you would increase, and that your voice would be clear this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have your Bible, turn to Acts chapter 2. I do want to mention a couple things we shared on Wednesday, just for a minute or two, just so you have a little bit of background. This is part 2 of part 1, Acts Church Now 2011. The Acts Church Now 2011. I'm titling this morning, The Power of One. The Power of One. If you've been like me, you've sat in church hundreds, probably thousands of times. And it's easy to go into like thinking about what's for lunch, and I don't even want to mention that because people are But you're thinking about things, and I want to encourage you this morning, if just for a few minutes, I won't speak long, but I believe there's a word of the Lord for many in this year that's going to ignite your destiny this morning. We talked about Wednesday in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, the whole basis of our faith. Jesus said, when he returns, will he find faith in the earth? Will he find people that really believe what he said? Or will he find people in church going through the motions? You know, I shared, you know, the statistic right now, Tulsa, Oklahoma, 30% of Tulsa, Oklahoma in the Bible Buckle Belt are unchurched. They're not in church this morning. Most of them are not in church. And another thing is, Sunday mornings is the most segregated time that we see. And if you look at Acts, we'll talk about this later on, the gospel penetrates and supersedes racial, ethnic, cultural divides, generational divides, and it breaks down all those walls. So this morning, I believe what I'm sharing will have a great impact on your family, upon your career, upon your marriage, upon your kids. But it all starts with faith. And the writer in Hebrews said, you know, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. And further down it says, by it the elders obtained a good report. This morning we have, I believe, the elders, the faithful, the mature. 30% or less are sitting in a church this morning. You are the ones during this season of time of the earth where many are falling away. Even our leaders, as the brother on CNN interviewed Bishop Jakes last night, had to comment on a fellow minister that has had some serious issues going on. Thank God for a couple, 50 years married, that have obtained a good report. Right? Any of you that are married, any of you that have been married 5 minutes, understand it takes faith. Right? Do I have a witness, anybody? And so, going down in Acts chapter 4, we talked about three basic results after the disciples prayed. I believe the church needs to pray more. Pastor called the church to pray morning and night, and personal time of prayer and corporate time of prayer. The Lord dealt with me this week. Son, you got to pray with your kids more. Just sit, even if it's 2 minutes, pray. Pray with your wife more. It's a season where we need to pray. But how many know it doesn't stop when you pray? That's just the beginning. And in Acts chapter 4, we talked about Wednesday, three things that happened after you prayed. The Holy Ghost shook their lives and they became bold. Number 2, the church became unified. If you see it there, unity resulting in great sharing, blessing, and generosity. People that had land sold their land and came and gave it to the apostles, said, use it for whatever you need. And no one in the church had a need. Everybody's PSO bill was paid. On time. Everybody's mortgage was either paid off totally or on time. That's what the Word of God says. This was a radical shaking and a moving. See, as Americans, sometimes we're not comfortable with really what the Bible says. Because, you know, I have a friend of mine who's an apostle in Uganda, and they'll walk for days to get to a meeting like this. There's a hunger for God. Why? I believe because they don't have, sometimes many of them have nothing but their faith. It's the substance. It's where they live. And some of us, you know, it's easy. I think sometimes we have a car that has air conditioning and heat, and we go to bed at night with food, more food in our refrigerator than most people are seeing in other countries in one city. And so, great sharing, great blessing. Number three, great power and grace to witness. Obviously, if less than a third of Tulsa has been reached with the gospel of Jesus Christ, we've got some work to do. Look at your neighbor and tell them we've got some work to do. We've got work to do. And this is not, as I shared Wednesday, the pastor's work. This is the work of every young person. You know, my son is 4 years old, and he used to go to Victory Christian Center. Now he goes to Union Public Schools. He said, "Dad, they don't talk about Jesus in this school." So I've been talking about Jesus to these other kids. Out of the mouth of babes, and something, witness can happen from that point all the way up. And so, great grace. Grace is the ability of God, not you trying to pull yourself up by your bootstraps. It's saying, "Lord, I receive the grace to witness to that person. I receive grace." So this morning we're talking about the power of one. If you found Acts chapter 2, I want to read from verse 1. And I'll read through verse 11. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. "When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place." Circle "one accord" if you can, or mark that. "And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one," circle that word "one," "sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance." Verse 5. "And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speak in their own language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, 'Look, are not all these who speak Galileans?'" In other words, "I know where these folk are all from." No. "And how is it that we hear each one in our own language in which we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya, adjoining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, church folk and folk from the streets." Okay. "Cretans and Arabs, we hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God." Verse number one, they were in one place. You know, you can be in one place and not be in one accord. Oh yeah. Anybody that's married understands this. Anybody that's been in church understands this. Anybody that's been on a team that has been a losing athletic team understand this. You can be in one place, have the same colors on, and not be in one accord. Or in today's language, not be on the same page. One of the number one reasons that people say, counselors and therapists say that marriages fail are finances, sex, and communication. I hear the sound of words, but I'm not hearing you. There's noise. You know what I'm saying? I mean, all the brothers know when you're watching, you know, you've got that. You can hear noise, but, what'd you say? Just, we're told a whole bunch of honeydews and you don't remember a word. You can be in one place. You can be on one team. I was one of the most frustrated high school athletes in the world. We had a team that just was not on the same page. And even though we had lots of talent, huge school up in Minnesota, Minneapolis, Minnesota. Great athletic program, but the players were not on the same page. Some wanted to go out on Thursday night and party, and some wanted to be all about this and all about that. And the coach had laid out, this is what we're to do. No one on the same page. And as a result, guess what? We didn't win. We didn't win. The freedictionary.com says that unity is the state or quality of being one or singleness. Unity is not just the absence of disagreement, it is the state of being one. This is why you can have churches on every corner. This is why you can have preaching going on. This is why you can have huge budgets of huge churches in this city. It's not the money. See, this is where the Holy Spirit started. And you can be in one place and not be in one accord, and the job does not get done. Because we're not in one accord. We're not one. And what do I mean by one? I mean, you get it. You understand it. The other day I read on Wednesday out of the bulletin, the vision area of the house wrote out point number three. One of the points of the vision for the members of this church to, through their lifestyle, through their life, not preaching, he said lifestyle, evangelism, through you living this out at work with the person that works in the cubicle or drives the truck with you, or they see your life. See, this is the Acts church. This is who they were. You mean somebody just sold everything and everybody got their bills paid? I need to go check that church out. There were a couple churches when I lived in Atlanta that had a burden for single moms. And a couple Sundays, I mean, these were churches, well-to-do churches. And they asked all the single moms to come up one Sunday. So I was in the service one day. There was about 20 of them. The pastor got a bucket and started handing keys out to every one of those moms. Many of them that they knew did not have cars, had jobs, but did not have cars. And they began to hand out. Now, these were not necessarily Cadillacs or Mercedes-Benz, but they gave cars, and they met a need. They went outside of the box. And let me tell you something about that church. Guess what? They were in one accord. They got it. They were on the same page. We're not just about coming in here jumping and hooping and hollering and swinging from the chandeliers, and we've got folk in our own midst that can't get the job done. They got it. They understood it. They realized this is not just about me coming and sitting, giving my tithe and leaving and being disconnected. I love that song, "In His Arms I'm Connected." I'm not disconnected, I'm safe. The church should be the most safe place, and I'm saying this is a safe place. Thank God for the history here, but I believe God's calling us to a whole nother level this morning. Can I hear an amen? And I believe God's going to speak to hearts this morning about that. Point number two. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one, fill in that blank, one sat upon each. You know, I would have thought, if it were me, I would have said there would be one big tongue of fire over everybody. And many pictures, actually, if you look online, it's just one big flame. But that's not what the scripture says. It says that individual tongues of fire came and sat on individual people. See, when the Holy Spirit comes with fire, he not only deals with the church as a whole, he deals with you. And he deals with me. And he gets in my closet, and he gets up under my rug. And not only is his job to sanctify and cleanse the dirt, the nasty stuff, His primary purpose is to make known Christ. And let me tell you something. When God begins to deal with you about making Christ known, Jeremiah said it's like a fire shut up in my bones. And then what does he do? He uses the individual gifts of people. See, Moses, all he had was a staff in his hand. And he said, take this staff, throw it down. God began to work miracles. Little boy, thousands of people, Jesus is preaching, they needed to eat. He came and gave his loaves and his fishes, and in the hands of Jesus, supernatural. But it was the act of making by the Holy Spirit, the motivation and the unction of the Holy Spirit, making what he had in his hand available. This morning, brothers and sisters, I believe you have things in your hand. I believe you have things in your house. I believe you have vision in your heart. I believe you have an unction from the Holy Spirit, a passion, a desire to reach others with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's not one big tongue of fire. There's a flame of fire upon your life. And he wants to use your gifts. Now, how many have been in churches where they try to cookie cutter you? Everybody's got to dress the same, wear the same kind of suit, the same kind of shoes. It's like trying to make robots. How many know God's not like that? He loves diversity. He made us with different personalities, different shades. People have been trying to figure me out for years. Is he? Is he Chinese? Is he Indian? I've been called everything in the book. But God loves diversity. I mean, go look outside. Look at, the Bible says the heavens declare. Every creation. You can't look at a tree or, you know, last year I was having problems with stress and anxiety, different things, and I decided I'm going to start walking in the morning. And I said, walking in my neighborhood, and I just realized, I never noticed that crack on the sidewalk, that nice crack. And I never noticed that tree and that bush, and, you know, there's neighbors that had certain types of cool-looking trees that, and I'm telling you, I began to really, just walking through my neighborhood experience, God slowing down. And let me tell you something, sometimes we never slow down, look at the mirror. And I'm not saying be narcissistic. I'm saying looking in the mirror and saying, God, I have been fearfully and wonderfully made. You know, just looking at yourself. God has given me some unique gifts and talents. See, sometimes what we've been, you know, trained in our mindset, we think, oh, it's just the pastor. He's got gifts. He's got talents. But church, you are the ones in Acts 2 that went out. I want to talk about this in a second. But those flames of fire, that motivation from God, that fire. You know, the thing that I want to talk about here is there's many, verse 11, many ethnicities speaking with one voice, the wonderful works of God. I mentioned that earlier, that Sunday morning is sometimes the most segregated time of the week. And yet we go to work, people can get together to make money. Walmart can get folks to come together every day. You look at their staff. You go to school, we can get kids together from different. Why do I think that is? Because the devil knows. If he can divide us, a divided house. See, I believe there's only one church in Tulsa, different locations. One church. One church. The Church of Jesus Christ, different locations. See, and if he can deceive us, if he can get us to think, I'm not connected to that. You know, I'm not really, that's just that church. When we begin to understand this church in Acts, and guess what happened? When they went in the street, I want to read that passage of scripture in verse 11. They went in the street and they were talking to folks in the street, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them speaking in our own tongues, the wonderful works of God. when the Holy Spirit comes. I don't care if you're a sports newscaster. I don't care if you're a teacher. I don't care if you're a garbage person. I don't care if you're a secretary. When the Holy Spirit comes to you, you know what I'm talking about. God gives you a grace and a sensitivity to be able to witness to that person. I mean, I work in a hospice, and I've got some of our nurses are really rough around the edges. I'm not going up to them, "Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah." No, I'm asking them how they're doing. And the Lord will put on your heart. I believe this is prophetic for this church. God's going to begin to open up the gifts of the Spirit. They're not, again, just for the pastor. The gifts of the Spirit, the working of miracles, where you'll just be walking to the water cooler and God will say, "There's something that you're supposed to pray for that person for now." I learned this from one of my mentors, Pastor Billy Joe Doherty. He'd be walking down somewhere and just would stop. And it wasn't that he was so great. It was the Holy Ghost in him. He would just stop. I've seen Pastor do this. I've seen Pastor Bellman do this. Stopping and listening and being sensitive to the Holy Spirit. This will apply even to your business. We're going to talk about this in a second. Many of you are called motivationally to give, and you're frustrated because you're only giving $10, $100, and in your heart, you have a heart to give millions to the church. Well, guess what? It's not going to happen by the sweat of your brow. It's going to come from that fire that is resting on your life. And the Holy Spirit directing you to be in the right place at the right time. In a famine, God always blesses his people. Always. Look through the scripture. When things are going down, I'm telling you, when the economy's going down, when they don't have enough food and things are looking crazy, God always puts his people and gives them raises and benefits and puts them in a place, a position of prosperity. It's just what he does. And so God wants to cause us to begin to not only have the fire, but begin to understand. Remember, this is why he blessed. They were in one accord. They understood. And we have a history in this city. Racial riots, division, right? Different things, hatred amongst folks. Guess what? That flame of God in your life is caused to shatter that and break that. Where you go up to people that wouldn't expect you to come up to and say, "Man, I've been praying for you." And or just bless them or do something motivated by the Holy Spirit. I mean, and I'm not talking about, I know sometimes in church we're real touchy-feely and we talk, women talk, but I'm talking to the brothers right now. So where you do something, men, you know, if it's a man's man, you're not coming up to them and, you know, hugging them necessarily. That's not going to get it. It's going to be something that a man can relate to. Am I making sense? Because, see, a lot of times, I don't want to go down this, but we've feminized the gospel. I love my wife. I love that she's feminine. I love that she smells good and dresses pretty and all that stuff. But how many know that God is a God of war? He's rough. Jesus was a carpenter. He didn't have finely manicured fingernails and hands. He could get down and get dirty. The guys that he hung with, the guys that he chose, were thuggish. That's just, Peter walked around with a sword in his hip pocket. He was. I mean, really.